say hello to my friend.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you.
Sorry, Pat.
Okay,
Pat. Well,
in your bulletin is the order form for the flowers, the poinsettias for the Christmas holiday. You have this week and next Sunday to place your orders. Okay? You can see me or you can see Deb. Morgan, yeah. Thank you.
Governor Matt.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the First Baptist Church of Medford. I am so very happy that each of you are able to be with us this morning. I wanted to let the congregation know that the American Legion of Medford has been incredibly generous with the church and donated 15 turkeys. And so I have 15 turkeys in the freezer across the street. If anyone knows a family that would like a turkey, if your family would like a turkey, if the thought of going to Stop and Shop this coming week fills you with great angst, come take a turkey from here. We have plenty of turkeys to go around to fill any need within the community. Please just speak with me after the service. You would be doing us a great favor and the American Legion a great favor. It's wonderful that they do this in appreciation for the Veterans Day breakfast that the church offers for the community. And it's a wonderful way of the community sort of all paying it forward to create some positivity and warmth in this very special time of year. So please, do not be shy. If you want a turkey, let's talk turkey.
Any other announcements? If not, let us prepare our hearts for worship in a moment of music and meditation.
sent Jesus Christ to rule over all things and made us servants in your kingdom. By your Spirit, empower us to love the unloved and to minister to all in need. Then at the last, bring us to your eternal realm, where we may worship and adore you and be welcomed into your everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who offend us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted.
Apostle Paul to the church in Colossae, the first chapter. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power. And may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and in earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrown to dominions or rulers or power. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through him, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Amen.
When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the others rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me paradise."
We would now like to invite the children to come forward to the children's message.
Yes, what is it?
The pitching bang.
It's a sky? Okay. What is it?
A piggy bang.
A piggy bang. Is that what it is? Do you all think it's a piggy bang?
It's a bank of the pigs.
It's a bank of the pigs. There you go.
What?
Really hold it close.
Yep, I will. I'm just taking out my paper. Okay, so today we're going to talk about stewardship. Do any of you know what stewardship is? Don't. Anybody? Why would we have a piggy bank in a stewardship talk? Any ideas?
I don't know what next.
You know a little bit? What little bit do you know?
I know a pig.
wondered, what, Jack? Tell us.
Six things. I'm talking about...
Talk into the microphone.
The big thing.
The big thing?
Yes.
Okay. How about Jaden? Go a little farther away. On the day of our story, Jesus had been teaching large crowds of people. When he was finished, Jesus and the disciples rested in the temple. They sat in what was called the treasury. So there was a big room next to the sanctuary that was the treasury, and they could see into the sanctuary. Right, Elizabeth? They sat in what was called the treasury. From there, Jesus could see the people putting their offering in the money box or in the bank, the piggy bank. They didn't pass offering plates through the crowd like we do. At the temple, folks went to the treasury and put their money in the money box whenever they felt like it. So Jesus watched people come and go, and they made their offerings to God in the treasury. He saw many rich people come along and put in large amounts of money. Then he saw a widow walk up quietly up to the treasury box. She slipped in two small coins into the box and quickly walked away. The coins together were worth more than one penny. About one penny. And yet, do you know that Jesus told his disciples? He said to them, "This poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury." went on to explain to all the other people he saw had given what they had left over. But the poor widow had given all that she had. Even if we don't have a lot, we all have something we can share with those who have less than we do. And even though giving to others makes our piggy banks lighter, it makes us and God very happy. So what will you guys do with your quarters today?
We'll put them inside the piggy bank.
You put them inside the piggy bank?
Yes.
Will you put both of them inside the piggy bank?
Yeah.
Will you keep one?
No.
What will you do?
We will take one at a time to put them in. I'm going to go first.
You're going to put them in?
Yeah.
Okay. That's very nice. Since you're giving back to the church. Isn't that nice? Because we like to come to the church each week. We like to hear the minister preach.
Oh,
I think. Or hear people talk about different things, like giving.
Like
right?
Thanksgiving.
Like Thanksgiving, because that's coming up this week. And then I have a paper here for all of you. And this is what the stewardship part means as well. So we're giving today, right, Nalia? We're giving today. But I'm going to give pass these out to you, and these are for all the children here today. Want to take one, Nathan?
I'll be
and one for Jaden.
I'm going to go out.
There you go. Put these pass those out to Jack and Alana.
Jack, you can have this one.
So on this, it says, this is for the First Baptist Church of Medford, because that's where we all come, right?
Yeah.
So I want you to take these home, and with your parents, you can fill these out, and then ask you what your name is, and how old you are, what grade you're in, and who you live with. And then it says, thank you, God, for your love, a place to worship you, and the people of this church family. I will gladly give my time to, and this is what, especially if people don't have money, or if they do, they can donate their time. So you might donate your time to tell people that you love them, to tell people that God loves them, to pray for our church, the minister and the leaders, or to attend Sunday school. For God works through his church, I will gladly give, and then it has amounts on here. You can give 25 cents a week, or 50 cents a week, a dollar a week, or any amount you choose per week. And every week you come, either in Sunday school or in church, you can put in an offering. So let's have a little prayer. Yeah. Come on up here, let's hold hands. So let's pray that all these rambunctious children have listened to the children's story well to get some ideas of what stewardship is about and giving back to our church for everything that our church gives to us. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
church.
Good morning.
So last week was this wonderful collaboration between Trish and Wendy to do this talk. And this week, for full transparency, I'm going to tell you that Mike was asked to do this, and his answer was, Kim would be glad to do it. And the truth is, any of you who have talked to me after church know that that's no problem for me to talk. But the task was the challenge because the topic is take time. And anyone who's asked me to do anything for the last 5 years knows that I've had these excuses. I'm in school, I'm writing a paper, yada, yada, yada. Even this morning it came in the back door and Alan said, you know you're on the program. So time and talking about time was challenging. I was even maybe putting this together a little bit this morning. And so as I thought, all week I kept coming back to the issue of faith more than time. And I remembered one of these talks that most inspired me, and it was Anthony here with a huge green bag of tabs, and Joan Union said, if you just bring in 10 tabs, we'll get to our goal faster. And I said, 10 tabs? That's mustard seed faith. I don't know if you can even see this. This is one tab. So if each of us bring in 10 tabs, we're going to have that big vat that Anthony had filled with tabs. And I started to think about it, and I went back, and I started to ask people for tabs. And a very interesting thing started to happen. I put out a little tiny jar at school, and I started asking students to throw your tabs in when you finish drinking something. Kids started to talk to me. Well, what are you collecting the tabs for, miss? And so I would tell them, and one very astute kid said, well, how much money do the Shriners get for all those tabs? I said, oh, last year they made about $300,000. And his eyes got very wide and he got very excited. And then I showed him the picture of the big green bags going into the vans, and he very sheepishly put his two tabs into my jar of tabs. Other students now come by a couple times a day, and they just smile and they stick a tab in the jar. And I realize that I've created time. Time to talk to students, time to talk to people. We have a very good family friend, and once a year, she comes up with a little baggie, and she says, here, I've been collecting these for you. Let's get together and have lunch. And so this mustard seed faith has turned into time that I wouldn't have had if I hadn't taken up a challenge that was given from this pulpit. So as I wind up my talk, I just want to say, let's take time to recreate some time. Maybe it's small. Maybe it's 30 seconds, a minute. Maybe it's your tab donation to the church drive, a small weekly offering, or hats and gloves for the kids when Barbara asks for them each year. The mustard seed lesson that Jesus gave us was that with this faith the size of a teeny tiny mustard seed, we can move mountains. So won't you take some time to move a mountain? Thank you.
As we will sing the next hymn, I would invite all of the members and regular attenders of the First Baptist Church, all who are pledging to come forward as we sing the hymn, and to bring and to set your pledge card in the basket in front of you. If you're visiting with us today, if you recently started coming to the church, please know that your presence with us is a great, great gift. And this is an opportunity for those who wish to make a financial commitment to the church for the coming year. But please feel no compulsion to do so. Everyone is free to give as they see, or also to remain seated as they feel appropriate. So we will sing together. We gather together, and as we sing the hymn, you can come forward and bring your pledge cards together.
As we come together now for the time of congregational prayer, I call your attention to those names and concerns printed in the bulletin for today. Among them are Rose Brooks and Betsy Burns, Brian Churchill, Ashley and Peter Colarossi, Ann Felch, Tracy Hughes, Greg Johnson, Pat Latham, Evgeny Lysov, Maxwell, Pam Meserve, Jamie Milord, Paul, Lori Pitsley, Leo and Jean-Robert Vazil, Luba Schneider, and Joan Union. Are there other names we've mentioned today or other causes for which we would give thanks? Actually, before we do, I would express my great appreciation for Greg Flynn, who is filling in on the organ for us today. Dr. Nancy Crandall was feeling quite under the weather this week. She called in yesterday. She's really exhausted from having moved to a new apartment and just has really been bedridden for the past several days. So I ask your prayers for Dr. Crandall, and if you are inclined to drop her a note or to give her a call, I know she would very much appreciate it. Are there others we've mentioned today? Pam?
I'd like to celebrate Diane's birthday.
Yes, we celebrate that Diane Johansson celebrated a birthday yesterday. We give thanks for you, Diane.
Yes,
we do. Others we've mentioned today? Tricia? Prayers for Anna and for Anthony. Others we mentioned today. Oh,
sorry,
Tricia. Tricia was celebrating the fact that one of the church's mission projects is to offer a Thanksgiving meal, actually a variety of holiday meals, at the Shelter for Women and Families on Central Avenue in Medford. And the group of volunteers from the church put that on this past Tuesday. It was very well attended. It was a beautiful, beautiful time of community sharing together. And thank you, Tricia, for keeping that organized. Others we've mentioned today. Pam.
Prayers for my longtime childhood friend, Lisa Lenington, who had a brain tumor removed yesterday.
Prayers for Lisa. Others we've mentioned. Lori. We pray for Richard and for strength in his journey ahead toward the end of life, and pray for all of those who will be supporting him in these days and who will feel his loss keenly. Others we've mentioned today. Kimberly.
Good morning. Yes, my mother, Mary Luke, who's hospitalized right now.
Prayers for Mary. Others we've mentioned. Chuck. Thanks for Alana. Others we mentioned today. Rand.
Thank the church for prayers for my wife Sally Peabody, who had a new knee on the 7th of November and is progressing nicely, and thank you, Matt, for your wonderful visit.
Prayers for Sally as she continues to gain strength and to heal from a knee replacement. Debbie. I called her by her sister's name earlier today. Debbie.
Yeah. My daughter Christina has a very close friend who has, as a result, become close to my husband and I. His mom and dad have been in mission work for a long time. And they went to visit now another brother of his that in Bangladesh, who also is in mission work. And while there, his dad suddenly passed away. And so his mother is still in Bangladesh. There's a lot of things going on there because of this. And when just 3 days ago, while she was there, she learned her father passed away. So really lift her up. She's there by herself. She doesn't speak the language and needs lots of...
What's her name?
Her name is Mrs. Ebb.
We pray for the
yeah.
Ebb family, particularly
Ebb
for
family.
Mrs. Ebb.
Yeah.
Others we've mentioned today. Let us pray. Almighty God, through your Son, our Lord, we know your mercy. We pray that we might capture in our imagination a glimpse of your glory. Jesus, Savior and Judge, you have confounded all earthly judgments by choosing to be numbered among us, among sinners. May your words comfort all who are in prison, all judged guilty by society or church, all who live on the margins of the human family. When you come to rule, O God, may we see your love. Jesus, condemned and powerless before your enemies, grant to the leaders of the peoples to know that their rule is limited and that it is in service to a greater law. Lord Christ, firstborn of the dead, through the blood of your cross, you give unity to the divided. Give to the church the hope of resurrection, that we may recognize the image of your Son in ourselves and in our neighbors. Holy Christ, image of the invisible God, free us from holding you in images of our own making. Grant that in the Spirit we may see all power and all life transformed by the compassion of the cross. Lord Christ, may we, with the dead, who have partaken of your holy meal, feast with you one day in paradise. Hear our prayers, O Lord, for those we name before you, particularly Rose, Betsy, Brian, Ashley, Peter, Anne, and Tracy, for Greg, Pat, Evgeny, Maxwell, Pam, Jermaine, and Paul, for Lori, Leo, and Jean Robert, for Luba and Joan, Diane, Anna, Lisa, Richard, Mary, Tracy, Nissa, Alana, Sally, and Mrs. Ebb. Hear our prayers for those we name in the silence of our hearts. Hear our prayers for those with no one left in this world to call their name before you. We acclaim you, O Christ, as the judge condemned to judgment, knowing that in your death, the world is given new life. Grant that we may seek your justice rather than human wisdom, and that all victims of human cruelty may share in the victory of life revealed in your death and rising. We join our prayers with the pleading of you, of your Son, who sits at your right hand, O God, and rules forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
May God's word only be heard. Amen. Please be seated. God's creatures are showing signs of change these days. The starlings, the little black birds, are filling the air with enormous flocks. They're so large, there's this technical word for them, murmurations. Swooping masses of thousands of birds whirling in the sky. Geese are honking overhead. The turkeys are even more bold than normal, strutting about with puffed chests and fanned tails. They don't know what's coming this week. And one of the most spectacular and extreme migrations in all of the world is the salmon run. After living in the ocean for several years, salmon migrate hundreds of miles upstream to the places where they were born. To start their journey, they instinctually begin following geomagnetic and chemical cues, things we have no perception of. These things guide them back to the entrance of their home streams. Then, recognizing the particular scent of their river, they travel upstream. This great trek requires incredible strength and endurance. They fight against the river's currents. They battle rapids. They jump over beaver dams and waterfalls, sometimes jumping as high as 12 feet. Not to mention navigating around the bears and the eagles and the fishermen, all waiting for their opportunity to catch their dinner. If the salmon are lucky, if they endure, they arrive safely to the gravel beds in the upper reaches of their home, the beacon leading them onward. There they give birth to a new generation. These amazing fish swim against the currents, facing all manner of obstacles for the sake of their whole species. They push towards this thing they do not fully understand, going toward an instinct that defies rationality. Swimming against their current is their way to ensure that life will go on, and that it will go on well. There is only one kind of salmon that swims with the current. That's a dead one. In our Old Testament lesson today, the prophet Jeremiah described a nation in turmoil. When the Israelites had covenanted with God, God intended for them to be guided by leaders who would care for the people as a shepherd cares for the flock of sheep. And however, as generations went by, new kings came who were not interested in the welfare of the people they served. They followed the current of the world around them. Like kings everywhere, they wanted to amass power. They wanted to amass wealth. They chose to serve their own interests, and in order to get there, they pitted people one against another so that they could hoard for themselves the power and hoard for themselves the wealth. But speaking to the prophet Jeremiah, God declared that these kings had failed. The shepherds had divided and scattered the flock. They did not attend to the people, and so God promised to intervene. God promised in the lesson today to raise up a righteous branch of David. This person's rule would be unlike other rulers in the world. This king would swim against the currents. He would be gracious, not focused on hoarding power, but would execute justice and righteousness. He would rule with compassion and love. His mission would be liberation, reconciliation, and acceptance for all people. When Jesus entered the world, things were just as chaotic and divided as they were in Jeremiah's time. Jesus did not come as an earthly king with a desire to rule with power. Instead, he came humbly. He taught about a new way of being, a way that went against the flow of the world as they knew it. Jesus swam against the current, and he cared for the vulnerable. He swam against the current and had compassion on those who he encountered, even the ones he challenged, even the ones who betrayed him. In our gospel lesson today, we heard just where leading like this got him. It was not to a seat of power. It was to a cross. It was not to be hailed as a great leader. Living this way brought him to his death. When Jesus pushed toward a new way of being in the world, the people felt threatened. And so they devised a way to get rid of him, to pretend as though he had never existed at all. As he was dying, Jesus had compassion for the thief beside him. He had compassion for those who called for his death. He had compassion for the ones who wept at the foot of his cross. In his death, he created life for all, reconciling us to God. His rule was unlike any other, earthly king, any before him, or any who would come after. Our world is not so very different from the world of Jeremiah that needed a Savior, from the world of Jesus that threw a Savior away. People who want power still pit us against one another in order to get it. Wealth and power are hoarded by those at the top while many others struggle. The currents of this world would lead us to carve out a life defined by our own self-interests, to hoard the power and wealth we can get while it's in our grasp. The currents of the world would wash us into winners and losers. The currents of the world would wash us to racism and sexism and classism and homophobia. The currents of the world would wash us to inequality and injustice. But Jesus calls us to swim against the currents of the world with every ounce of our strength. We need to swim upstream to follow this beacon that Christ has given us. We encounter divisiveness everywhere. People set up in camps, unwilling to listen to one another, to hear the truth others can speak. And as we gather together in just a few days for the Thanksgiving holiday, I imagine that certain of us might feel twinges of anxiety about sitting down with people and having conversations, conversations that might explode when someone steps on a landmine or topic. The theologian Stanley Hauerwas has offered his vision for what the church ought to be, for what the church ought most to care about. He writes, "We would like a church that asserts that God, not nations, rules the world, that the boundaries of God's kingdom transcends those of Caesar, and that the main political task of the church is the formation of people who see clearly the cost of discipleship and are willing to pay the price." Do our commitments, do the things that stir the deepest feelings and emotions in ourselves, make us disciples of Jesus Christ? This, This is the sole criterion by which we must judge our lives. It is the sole criterion by which we must judge ourselves. Jesus didn't look for power, but to have compassion on everyone he encountered, even for those that challenged him, for those who betrayed him, for those even that killed him. The way that Jesus bids us walk lifts up the fallen. It comforts the suffering, it gives drink to the thirsty and food to the hungry. The way of Jesus embraces failure. It embraces loss and even embraces death for the sake of love. This alone is worthy of our allegiance. This is the beacon leading us onward. The one we follow against all of the other currents around us. Whatever the obstacles, we must follow the path of Christ's love, even when it makes little sense, even when it does not seem to be to our advantage. As Christians, Jesus is our great shepherd. He is our king. And we look to him above any other power that would beg for our allegiance. We have a higher citizenship, serving our neighbors in Christ's name. There's only one kind of salmon that swims with the current, a dead one. And the same is true of our faith. There's only one kind of faith totally at home in the downward currents of our world's politics. There's only one kind of faith totally at home in the realms of power, occupied by strength and greatness. The Apostle Paul offered a prayer for us to live a different way. May you be made strong with all of the strength that comes from his glorious power. And may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father. When the powers of this world would try to divide us, may we be like the salmon, fighting against the current, navigating rapids and jumping over hurdles and facing dangerous obstacles for the sake of our common good. The love of Christ alone is our beacon. It calls to us through the centuries. It is our sole rule of life. Christ is our King. We are his people, brought together under his most gracious rule. Amen. Of your own we give to you. Bless these gifts, bless all who have given, and bless all who will receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
world. Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify our God in heaven. And as you leave this place, may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.